Hi, welcome back. And if you're new to my channel, welcome. My name is Juan, and I talk about books here on YouTube regularly, usually about once a week. I hope you're doing well. Thank you for being there. I really appreciate it. So today I want to continue talking about my collection of Latin American literature. This video is part two of a two-part series on books from Latin America. So I'm going to link to part one here in case you have not watched the first video yet. You can watch this video first if you like, but if you feel like I'm missing an author, chances are that I mentioned them in part one. So like in the previous video, I will show you my favorite Latin American books that I own, but this time I will also do a small book haul at the end with books I own but haven't read yet. So you can think of this video as a mixture of a bookshelf tour, book recommendations, and a book haul. The reason I'm going to show you some of the books that I haven't read yet is that I am hoping that this video will motivate me to read them soon. And also, I would like to get your opinion if you have read any of them and whether you think I might enjoy them or not. But let me start with an author that I know some of you missed in part one. And I am referring to the Brazilian genius that was and is Clarice Lispector. Last year, I made a video about Lispector, and I devoted that whole episode to her and the books by her that I had read so far. I'm going to link to that video here as well, because I think many of you would like to watch that if you haven't already. That video was subtitled in Portuguese, because I wanted to reach Brazilian and other Portuguese-speaking viewers. By the way, in case you don't know, my videos are usually subtitled in English. Sometimes I also subtitle them in other languages. All you need to do in order to activate the subtitles is press the CC button and they should come up automatically. And to find out if there are options in other languages, in languages other than English, just check the settings. Now, subtitling takes a lot of time and effort, but I like to do it because I want my videos to be as accessible to as many people as possible. And I know many of you appreciate that. Now, going back to Clarice Lispector, the first book by her I'd like to talk about is The Passion According to GH, or in Portuguese, A Paixão Segundo GH, which was first published in 1964. Now, the plot of this great novel couldn't be simpler. A well-to-do Brazilian woman enters her former maid's room and encounters a cockroach. That just doesn't sound too compelling, does it? And yet, many people consider this novel one of the most important works in Brazilian literature. I have not read enough Brazilian literature to be able to say that myself, but what I can say is that this novel is one of the strangest, most absorbing reading experiences I have ever had. But it is not for everyone. Some people might find it too mystical or even abstract. I think that the effect reading this novel will have on you will probably depend on how much you are willing to let go and immerse yourself in Lispector's language and in your state of mind when you read it. I own this Spanish translation, but I've heard that the book has a really good English translation as well, which I'm going to link to in the description box as usual. Although the books I'm going to show you in this video are in Spanish or Portuguese, when available, I have linked to them in English as well as in the original languages in the description box below. If you buy any books from my links, I will receive a small commission. It will not cost you any extra, but you will be supporting my channel, which would be incredibly nice of you. Thanks. Now, I wish I had read this in the original Portuguese, but I found this novel in a local bookstore here and I just couldn't help buying it. I own two other books by Clarice Lispector, this time in Portuguese, which might be a little bit more accessible than The Passion According to GH, but I really don't know. I think her most accessible book is probably The Hour of the Star, A Hora da Estrela, which I have also read in Portuguese, but unfortunately I do not own it, so, you know, in print book form, so I cannot show it to you right now. But if you have not read anything by Clarice Lispector yet and want to dip your toes in her fiction, I would probably recommend The Hour of the Star as a starting point. It is a great novel in its own right, and it is a lot more accessible than the other books by her I have read so far. But going back to the two books I own by her in paper format, I would like to show you next Family Ties, or in Portuguese, Laços de Família. Clarissa Spector, was born in Ukraine but grew up in the northeast region of Brazil before moving to the more prosperous southeastern region and establishing herself in Rio de Janeiro. However, she spent a decade of her adult life living in Europe and the US because she was married to a Brazilian diplomat. Lispector began publishing books when she arrived back in Brazil in 59, and one of her earliest and best pieces of work is her short story collection Family Ties, published in 1960. But the short stories in this collection were written in the 1940s and 50s, and some of them had been published in newspapers before in Brazil. I think this short story collection is also a good way to start with Lispector, and if you want to read her work, I would definitely recommend reading Family Ties before reading The Passion, according to G.H., if you want to see what Lispector's style is like and what themes she's most interested in. I think it makes more sense to check out these short stories before you commit to a whole novel by her. But I don't want to give you the impression that she's this overwhelmingly difficult author. While Lispector is not the most accessible writer from Latin America, she's also not impossibly difficult, okay? And if you get what she's trying to do, you will greatly enjoy her writing. There are only 8 stories in Family Ties with different lengths, but none of them is really long. You can see it is a very slim volume. I know that not everyone is into short stories, however, I myself do prefer reading novels in general, but sometimes short stories can be a good entryway for writers with a very specific and unusual style, and that is the case with Lispector's writing. But if you have already read some of her works before and you're feeling perhaps a little bit more adventurous, you could try your luck with Agua Viva from 73. In Portuguese and in Spanish, the word, in the Spanish that we speak in the Canary Islands anyway, Agua Viva means jellyfish, but thankfully they kept the Portuguese title for the English edition of this novel because it sounds a lot better, okay? Agua Viva is probably the most difficult novel by Lispector I have read so far, to me. It is structured as a monologue by a female plastic artist, so it has no conventional plot or characters. But I love the reading experience with this novel, and if you're used to stream of consciousness, if you have read a lot of books by the likes of Virginia Woolf or James Joyce, then I would say you're more than ready to tackle this one. Okay, let's stay in Brazil, but go back to the 19th century and talk about one of the most acclaimed, most famous, and most widely read novels from that South American country. And I'm referring, of course, to Don Casmurro by Machado de Assis. Don Casmurro is a novel from 1899. I own this Portuguese edition from Portugal, Don Casmurro. The novel belongs to the realist tradition, so if you have read 19th century realist fiction by European writers, you will enjoy this a lot, I think. This novel is a masterpiece and one of the best novels about jealousy that I have ever read. The protagonist and narrator of this novel is a man named Bento Santiago. He falls in love with a young woman named Capitu, whom he marries and has a child with. However, Bento is so jealous and insecure that he becomes convinced that he is not the child's real father. Of course, like many first-person narrators, Bento is an unreliable narrator, so how much of his story you believe, including the paternity of her son, is up to you, the reader. Don Casmurro is a delightful novel. You will have a lot of fun reading it, so I strongly recommend it. Okay, let's now change the register completely and talk about one of the hottest fiction writers from Argentina. I discovered Mariana Enriquez last year, and I am so glad I did. Some of her books are now available in English translation, which is great news. I have The Dangers of Smoking in Bed, or in Spanish, Los Peligros de Fumar en la Cama, which is a short story collection. And in this book, she mixes the political with the supernatural. I might not be the right person to talk about this collection, actually, because I don't like to be disturbed by fiction in the sort of way that this book is meant to disturb its readers. The stories in this book are disturbing and full of dark, haunting images. So I would say that this is great horror writing, but perhaps not the kind of horror that you might be used to if you only read American, North American, or European writers. There is something uniquely Latin American about the stories in this collection, and that is what appeals to me most about Enriquez's writing. I also appreciate how she talks about real-life horrors like the last military dictatorship in Argentina that went on, as you know, between 76 and 83. Another element that might speak to readers no matter their background is how Enriquez tackles male violence against women here. I think if not all, at least some of the stories in The Dangers of Reading in Bed will speak to your deepest fears. Unfortunately, I don't think that the novel Nuestra Parte de Noche is available in English translation yet. I looked it up, but I could not find any information about a possible English translation. The novel's title would translate literally as Our Share of the Night. But who knows if that is how they will translate it, if they ever do. Thematically, this novel has a lot in common with the short story collection I just showed you. Also, you know, there are supernatural elements. The political situation in Argentina during the last military dictatorship is also here, you know, that kind of thing. But I particularly enjoyed the first part of the novel where we focus on the relationship between a father and his young son. Again, I am not an avid reader of horror, so this novel is probably not for me, which means that I'm going to be cautious and not recommend it blankly. But I think that if you read horror or if you're not put off by the idea of reading something that will give you nightmares, you should try to read this novel if you can. I was a lot more successful, a lot more into the next novel that I have for you today. I tried to read Three Sad Tigers or Three Trapped Tigers or Tristes Tigres in Spanish years ago, but I struggled with its style. But then, last year, fortunately, I decided that I needed to read it because it is an acclaimed novel and many consider it one of the key works in literature in Spanish written in the 20th century. Its author, Guillermo Cabrera Infante, who was exiled in Europe, he was Cuban, he was exiled in Europe for many years, he lived in London, England, and published most of his books in Spain. And in fact, he struggled to publish this novel back in 67 because of government censorship in Spain, because back then the country was ruled, as you know, by a right-wing dictator, and the official censorship was ultra-conservative. I would not say that this book has a lot of sex, but clearly enough to upset a moralistic, fundamentalist Catholic censor. This edition is, of course, uncensored, and it includes the reports from the censor's office at the end, and I had a lot of fun reading those. The title of the novel comes from a Spanish tongue twister that would literally be translated as Three Sad Tigers, but that would remove the alliteration and the tongue twister element, which is why the novel is better known in English as Three Trapped Tigers. This novel is set in Cuba before the revolution. A lot of the action takes place at night and in nightclubs. Cabrera Infante seeks to reflect Spanish as spoken in Havana here, and he also uses a lot of English. So that makes the novel fun to read for someone proficient in Spanish, familiar with Cuban Spanish, which I think most native Spanish speakers are, and who speaks quite a bit of English. So I know my mom tried to read this novel and she bailed because she doesn't speak any English, so she didn't get some of the puns and references in this novel. That's when it gets a bit difficult. And I wonder how this novel would translate into other languages, but I suspect that a lot would be lost in translation. So if you can read Tristes Tigres in the original Spanish, this novel is ambitious, bold, colorful, complex, can be dizzying and meandering at times, but it is definitely a must read of Latin American literature. There is a section in this novel where Cabrera Infante writes in the style of the most acclaimed Cuban writers at the time, and although I didn't get all the references because I'm not that well read, I thought that was such an irreverent and difficult exercise. So I admired this novel a lot and would like to read more by Cabrera Infante in the future. But what about going back south again to Argentina? So Manuel Puig is one of the best known Argentinian writers of the last century, and perhaps his most famous novel is The Kiss of the Spider Woman, or in Spanish, El Beso de la Mujer Araña, which was first published in 1976. Now, this novel has been turned into a play and then a movie, which for some reason is set in Brazil instead of in Argentina, and a Broadway musical. The Kiss of the Spider Woman is mainly structured around a series of conversations between two inmates in an Argentinian prison. One of them, Valentina Regi, is a political prisoner, and the other one, Luis Molina, was arrested for corruption of a minor, quote-unquote. This novel opens with Molina describing a scene from a classic horror movie named Cat People from 1942, and that is just the first of a series of movies that Molina recounts for Arregui. This is an engaging novel that I would recommend to everyone watching this video for sure. Okay, now let's move on and go to Colombia and Laura Restrepo. I bought this secondhand copy of her novel Delirium, or in Spanish, Delirio, which was originally published in 2004. It's been a while since I last read this novel, but I remember finding it quite disconcerting. I also remember that it was mainly set in Colombia in the 1980s. It is also polyphonic, so different characters take turns at narrating the novel from their point of view. I think an interest in Colombia and some prior knowledge about the social and political circumstances in that country in the 1980s might help make the most of this novel. I have a much better memory of reading another Colombian novel entitled Our Lady of Assassins, or in Spanish, La Virgen de los Sicarios, by Fernando Vallejo. This very slim novel was first published in 1994, and I want to say that I read it for the first time not long after. It is about a writer named Fernando, who moves back to his hometown, Medellin, in Colombia, after spending many decades away. The city is ravaged by drug trafficking-related violence, and Fernando falls in love with a 16-year-old male prostitute who also works as a hitman, or in Spanish, a sicario. As you can expect, this novel is incredibly violent, but what I admire about it, it's its frank, head-on treatment of male homosexuality, which is like nothing else I have ever read. It is not something I expected to encounter in a novel about organized crime, but it really, really works. Okay, let's now talk about Pedro Páramo by Juan Rulfo, which is the best ghost story I have ever read. I have reviewed this great Mexican novel from 1955 before, so I'm going to link to it here in case you want to hear my thoughts on it. The only thing I'm going to say right now about it is that it is a transformative novel. If you only want to read one Mexican book, you could do a lot worse than reading Pedro Páramo. To me, this is the Mexican novel, period. I also wanted to recommend the work of other Latin American writers that I have read, even though I don't currently own any books by them that I could show you. For example, I'm very intrigued by the Argentinian novelist César Aira. He's extremely prolific, and that kind of puts me off a little bit, although it shouldn't, because it mostly means that there are plenty of novels by him that I could choose from. And staying in Argentina for a second, I also admire Fever Dream, or in Spanish, Distancia de Rescate, which is a novel from 2015 by Samantha Schweblin. Only last week, I watched the movie adaptation of the novel, co-written by her and directed by Claudia Llosa, which is available in Netflix right now, on Netflix. I thought that adaptation was as brilliant as the novel. I will not talk about the plot here, because I think that in this case, it is a lot better to go without knowing what to expect at all. But that is one of the most original novels I have ever read. And then last summer, I finally read Hurricane Season, or in Spanish, Temporada de Huracanes, by the Mexican writer Fernanda Melchor. Not necessarily my thing once again, but the hype is more than justified, okay? Hurricane Season is a stirring and suspenseful read that I would also recommend to you. Of course, there are a lot of other Latin American writers whose work I have read and admire, like, Mario Vargas Llosa or Alejo Carpentier from Cuba. One of my key reading interests is in literature from that region, so I try to read as much Latin American fiction, whether in Spanish or Portuguese, as I can. But now it's time to go on a mini book haul, which the books I own but haven't had the chance to read yet. I would like to start with the Mexican writer Elenia Poniatowska and her novel Here's to You, Jesusa, or in Spanish, Hasta no verte, Jesús mío. I own this Mexican edition that I bought in a secondhand bookshop in England, of all places, many years ago, but which inexplicably I have not read yet. Now, this novel is from 1969, and it is set to tell the story of a poor woman named Jesusa Palancares. I don't know much else about this novel, so I should probably read it soon and find out more about it so I could tell you my thoughts. Its author, Elena Poniatowska, although also famous for being a journalist in Mexico, is one of the best known and most acclaimed living writers in Mexico. And at the time of making this video, she is 89 years old. And then I have this novel by the Argentinian writer Juan José Saer. This tome is entitled La Grande and was published posthumously in 2005. I also stumbled upon this novel in a secondhand bookshop, and I bought it because I have been intrigued by this writer for years. I haven't read anything by him yet, and this might not be the best novel to start with. I don't really know. But anyway, let's talk about the last two novels I have. They belong to my boyfriend, but I could read them, of course, if I wanted to, and I probably will. The first one is La Invasión del Pueblo del Espíritu from 2020 by the Mexican writer Juan Pablo Villalobos. I don't know much about this novel, but I have heard it is a joy to read, so I'll report back when I have read it, as I will with the last novel I have for you today, which is entitled Una Cita con la Lady, and is the debut novel of the Mexican writer Mateo García Elizondo, also from 2020. I have read that this is a promising debut, and I'm always excited to read promising debuts. So yeah, these are all the books I had for you today. I hope that you have enjoyed this video, and part one, of course, but please let me know if you have read any of the books in the comment section below. And of course, I would also love to hear which are your favorite books by Latin American writers. I will see you again very soon on my next video, of course. Take care.